and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, as I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me, and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If you do not remain in me, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire and burned. If you remain in me, and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Now remain in my love. If you could keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I have learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. And so whatever you ask in my name, the Father, will be given to you. This is my command: love each other.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Great. Well, morning, everyone. Nice to see you. My name is Matt. I'm one of the leaders here. And today, as you may have noticed, we're concluding the final talk in our I Am series, I Am the True Vine. And as I begin, I want to ask you a question to reflect on. You don't have to speak to anybody next to you about your answer. It's just for you to think about. And this is the question: what do you think God feels when he thinks about you? What do you think God feels when he thinks about you? And I hope that your immediate answer is love. Of course, love, of course. God feels an overwhelming, never-ending sense of love for me when he thinks about me. But of course, it is possible that for some of us, that the answer is, yeah, love, sure, but perhaps he's a little bit disappointed me at the same time. One of my reflections since becoming a parent in the last couple of years is realizing the amount of love that I have for my children, which has been sort of shockingly overwhelming. I've just gone, wow, gosh, if God is a perfect father, how much more must my Father in heaven love me? But I'm also aware that I'm the kind of dad who loves my kids, but also loves closing the bedroom door at night and going, goodbye, see you again another time. And perhaps God's a little bit like that. God loves me, but... God loves me, but probably he wearily rolls his eyes when I do that thing I promised him and myself that I won't do for the millionth time. God loves me, but he's probably a little bit frustrated that I haven't been checking in with him quite so much recently. And of course, for some people here, you might think that God isn't really thinking about you very much at all. Perhaps you feel looked over, as though God's not concerned or a little bit indifferent. So, what do you think God feels when he thinks about you? We'll come back to that question in a little bit. And for now, what I want to do is just offer a little bit of context and touch on a few key points from this very familiar passage we just had read. And then at the end of my talk, as we close the service, we're going to share communion with one another. So there's disagreement about how is best to structure John's gospel, but there is a popular view that we can structure it by there being two main sections to his gospel. Firstly, there's the book of signs. This contains the seven miracles, or signs, hence the name that Jesus performed, a bit like feeding the 5,000, turning water into wine, healing the man by the pool who'd been invalid for 38 years. And these signs act as a demonstration to show Jesus' power and his identity and invites people to come and believe in him for who he is. And then secondly, there's the book of glory, which starts with Jesus washing his disciples' feet at the Last Supper and then focuses on the events surrounding his death and then resurrection. And our reading comes somewhere towards the beginning of this second part of Jesus' journey towards the cross. So Jesus has washed his disciples' feet in John 13, and much of that chapter and the next chapter is spent around the dinner table with Jesus comforting and preparing his disciples for what is about to happen next, including the statement that Jermaine read a couple of weeks ago when he said that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And then, at the end of John chapter 14, Jesus says, "Come now, let's leave." And so Jesus and the disciples, they're full, and they leave the room where they've been sharing a meal, and they begin to walk out into the city before finally crossing the Kidron Valley to the Garden of Gethsemane in John 18, where Jesus is eventually arrested. Now, Jesus does not want to waste any precious time in this moment. He still has much to teach his disciples. And so I like to imagine this little scene between John 14 and John 18 as a bit of sort of a West Wing style walk and talk. Jesus playing sort of the Jed Bartlett, walking ahead, and the disciples trying to catch up, tripping over things as they go. So they're walking through the streets of Jerusalem with the disciples in tow, and something sparks Jesus and inspires this piece of teaching that he's going to bring to them about the image of a vine. And it was very common for rabbis in that day to just use things that caught their attention, something that they could see and show their disciples and use it as a teaching point. So you see a shepherd, it's the perfect opportunity to share a parable about a sheep that wanders off. You see an old lady leave a very few tiny coins in the collection plate, it's a great opportunity to teach about the generosity that God desires. And so perhaps Jesus, he's wandering the streets with his disciples and he's seen like a potted vine outside someone's house. Or perhaps he can see in the hillside in the distance that there are vineyards over there. We don't know for sure because John doesn't tell us. But I hope that you will allow me a little bit of speculation, a little bit of imagination as we try and discern what might be happening here. And I might be completely wrong, but let's see what you think. The Roman historian Tacitus recorded that a golden vine was found in the temple in Jerusalem. And the Jewish Roman historian Josephus recorded that the entrance to the temple, golden vines were there, which clusters of grapes hung as tall as a man. So perhaps Jesus is walking the streets and down a little alleyway. He sees the temple in the distance, lit up maybe, and he catches a glimpse of those clusters of enormous man-sized grapes adorning the temple. And in true Aaron Sorkin style, he dramatically stops. He turns to his disciples and says, "Do you see those? You see those massive vines on the temple? They're impressive, right, aren't they? Well, I am the true vine." Cue credits. So he looks at the temple maybe, and he sees those. He says, "I am the true vine." And what he's saying, if this is the case, is you see the temple, you see those priests, you see that Passover sacrifice that's going to take place tomorrow, the center of your worship, the center of your religious and national identity for the whole of your life and your parents' life and your grandparents' life. Yeah, it's not going to be found there anymore. It's going to be found in me. If the I am statements make particular claims about Jesus and his identity as God in the flesh, well, his last, he says, "All of life as you know it is now found in me. That is who I am." Psalm 80 says, "You brought a vine out of Egypt." And so this golden vine that was on the outside of the temple was an image of Israel themselves. Israel had been taken out of enslavement in Egypt and planted by God to produce good fruit. Later, the prophet Isaiah said, "I will sing for the one I love a song about his vineyard. My loved one had a vineyard on a fertile hillside. He dug it up and cleared it of stones and planted it with the choicest vines. He built a watchtower in it and cut out a winepress as well. Then he looked for a crop of good grapes, but it yielded only bad fruit." And so Jesus looks at the temple, possibly, and says, "I am the true vine, and the Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes that it will be given even more fruit. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me as I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. So a fairly simple image and teaching that Jesus is offering. Jesus is the vine. God is the vine dresser or the gardener, and Jesus' disciples, that is to say, us as well, are the branches. And so on one level, Jesus could be speaking with Israel in mind. Jesus is the true and complete fulfillment of what the original image of the vine failed to be. Jesus will not fail to produce fruit, however, and anybody who's connected to him as branches will produce fruit. And Jesus tells his followers that you are part of me. You and I, we are one now. This thing that I am doing, God, the vine dresser, the gardener, he's behind it. He's involved in it, but you are involved too because you are a part of me and I have plans for you and for your life to produce fruit. And so as with every I am saying, he reveals something about who he is. He knows he's about to die. He knows that his friends are going to be left without his physical presence very soon. And what he wants to tell them is that I am the source of your spiritual life. Like a vine nourishes its branches, Jesus provides spiritual nourishment for those who remain connected to him. So just as Jesus' earthly ministry begins to come to a climactic close, his disciples' ministry is really only just beginning, and he wants them to know that they cannot do it without his help. The fruit that will come through them will come through their connection with Jesus. And this is, of course, still completely true for us today as well. The only way for us to produce spiritual fruit is through an intimate connection with Jesus. And so remaining in his love means that we attach ourselves to him, and his life and his love and his power flow to us, and they flow through us as we go out and share what we have with the world. And so if you want to be part of what Jesus is doing, you must remain in his love. Or as another translation puts it, you must abide in his love. And so what does it mean to abide in Jesus' love? I think quite rightly, this has been connected to or linked with our spiritual formation. To do the very things that allow us to become aware of God's presence and his love. To grow in things like prayer and fasting and meditation and reading the Bible and really being committed and obedient to what God has called us to do and asked us to do. We see this just a little bit after. He says, if you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept the Father's commands. How can we possibly think that we're going to abide if we're never intentional about connecting with him? If we don't pursue him, if we don't follow his example of going off to a quiet place to pray, just as he does in all of the Gospels, how can we abide in Christ if we're not attentive to and obedient to his voice in Scripture? I love how Psalm 1 puts it, and I'm sure this is a psalm that the disciples would have known all too well. It says, blessed is the one whose delight is in the law. That's a word for the Scripture, the first five books of the Bible. Who meditates on the Scriptures day and night. That person's like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither, whatever they do prospers. That's what it's like. That is what it's like when we keep ourselves close to Scripture. We keep God's voice close to us in the center of our lives. It's like being planted next to sustaining water. And it really doesn't matter whether you're producing fruit in this moment or not, because fruit grows at particular times. There are seasons for growing fruit, and there are seasons when we don't produce so much fruit. But remain connected to the vine. Remain connected to the source of life, and you will produce fruit at the allotted time. It's Jesus' promise. And so when it comes to reading the Bible, you really want to be planted. You want to be grounded, connected to the source. And I think that a routine is really important when it comes to reading the Bible. Sporadic reading the Bible is okay, but a routine's better. Sporadic reading the Bible is better than no reading the Bible at all. And so I'd love to encourage you, as I'm sure you already do, is to put time aside each day to make sure that you are drawing from the source of life so that you will bear fruit in the right season. I think have a plan. have a routine, set time aside each day, and expose yourself to the breadth of Scripture. Don't just read the verses that are your favorite. Oh, do not be anxious about anything, but with everything, go bring prayers and petition, or whatever your favorite things. Expose yourself to the breadth of it. Try to read all of it. You don't have to read all of it in a year. Read a little bit. I think we have so much content at our fingerprints, at our fingertips these days, that we just overwhelm ourselves. Just a few verses. Read a few verses from Scripture each day and ask God, what are you saying through this, and how can I live this out? Just read a little bit and ask the Lord to come into it. And I think even if you read it that day and you go, I'm not really sure what that was about. Or you read it another day and you go, I'm not quite sure if I can see how this is making a difference. The point is you're planted. You are next to the source. And the transformative power of God by his Spirit in his word is transforming you. And I think that people who do this for a long period of time, they look back and they see how they have been connected to streams of living water. And it produces fruit in its proper season. You'll look back and you'll be grateful for the way that God has brought his transformation through this. And I know you know this, but our website's got tons of resources about prayer and reading the Bible. We've got an app, got a devotional series which is going through the New Testament in a year right now, Every Day with Matt. You can find out more about that on our website. But I think Jesus is saying to these disciples, take your responsibility seriously for staying connected to me. You're like a tree. You're like a vine. You take your nourishment day by day, minute by minute, second by second. A tree or a vine receives its nourishment and sustains its branches so it can develop its fruit. Jesus uses the image of a vine because the vine doesn't just take a big gulp on a Sunday, but it's constantly receiving throughout. So what else does Jesus say about abiding? He says, as the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Now remain in my love. So there's an element to our abiding which is a little bit down to us, where we seek to connect with God, we pursue him, we make space for him, we allow for our hunger and our thirst to be quenched only by the true vine and not by other vines that deliver little but offer much. But more than responsibility, there is the abiding that is really based in our relationship. And I think what Jesus is inviting his disciples into now is into the relationship with him. We have relationship, but when I'm gone, you can remain connected to me. And what I want you to do is, as you remain in my love, what I want you to know is that you are remaining in a love that has existed before the creation of the world. As the Father has loved me, so I love you. Now remain in my love. I don't know, do you ever do like a spiritual stock take of your relationship with God? You sort of go like, how am I doing right now with you, Lord? My wife and I, we often, when we're having like our check-ins, like how are you doing emotionally, physically, spiritually, it's like, we do that every so often to ask ourselves the question, how are we doing in our relationship with God? Now I wonder, if you ever do sort of ask that question of yourself, do you ever find that when you're in a bad place, when you've had a week from hell, when your finances aren't in the right place, your job's not going how you want, your relationship's a little bit fraught, that your relationship with God is also not that great either? It's like, oh, God feels distant right now, or it feels like he's not here. I think that's quite a normal experience for people to say. And I think we so easily develop a relationship with God that's sort of based on our feelings. And if we're having a good day, we're having a good day with God. And if we're having a bad day, we're having a bad day with God. But I think what Jesus is saying in this verse 9, that God's intention for our relationship with him is not really built on how we feel. As important as our emotions and how the situations of our lives are, he's saying, don't build your relationship on how you feel about me, but on how I feel about you. As the Father has loved me, so I've loved you. Now remain in that love. And I think that's the invitation for us to build our relationship with God on. So, what does God feel when he thinks about you? Back to the question I asked at the very start. And I would like to assure you today that God's love is permanent to you. As Jesus says in our reading, verse 4, you are already clean because of the word I've spoken to you. And this is absolutely key to our understanding of the gospel, of how God is at work in our lives. The Bible gives no indication that God is disappointed in you, or that despite his love, that he's rolling his eyes exasperatingly at you. God is not angry with you. Quite the contrary, God is gracious. He is compassionate, and he loves you because he loves you because he loves you because he loves you. Do you know that God is nice and he likes you? Because if you do know that God is nice and he likes you, there's a good chance that you're probably abiding in his love. And it's so important for all of us to know the reality of God's love for us, but also to experience it, to come close and to allow for his pleasure to fill us, to experience his beautiful and never-ending affection for us. He goes on and says, "You are now my friends," which must have been a massive thing for the disciples to have heard, huge. And I think abiding ultimately is about enjoying our friendship with God. And this particular word in the Greek, it's a bit like, it's a royal word. It's kind of like saying you're like the Chancellor of the Exchequer, or perhaps something more relational. You're like the best man at a wedding. It's like you're in the inner circle. You know everything. You know his business. And this is how God is, because all that Jesus wants is friendship. He wants friendship with you. He wants to know everything about you. He cares for you. He cares about the things that concern you, and he's interested in them. And so enjoying Jesus' presence, that really has to be the start of prayer. So we abide and we enjoy his presence. Believe that Jesus really cares about you. He longs for you to know his love. And he wants you to bring your cares and your sorrows and your worries and your joys to him. And ultimately to remain in his love, to abide in the love that he already experiences with the Father. So this is an imperfect analogy, forgive me. But it's one that's been coming to my mind in the last couple of days as I've been thinking about what it means to abide in God's love, but also how we can grow in this experience. So my daily routine starts with my son waking up, and I bung him on the sofa, give him some milk, stick Bluey on the TV, go into the kitchen, make myself a cup of tea, think, when did my life start at 5 o'clock in the morning and when's it going to change again? And then I bring my tea back into the living room and I sit at the other end of the sofa and I scroll through Twitter. Yes, I've done Jenny's parenting course. Leave me alone. We've just had our second child, and that's meant that during the paternity leave, I had a lot more time with our firstborn than I have had previously. I mean, I work from home a fair bit, so I see him quite a lot, which is nice. But I ended up going to gymnastics classes and soft play and multi-sensory groups and for walks in the buggy around the park. And as I spent time with Caleb, we'd snack together. I found the things that he found funny, and I laughed at them as well. We got to play some games together, got to see how his character had developed around other children with the groups he was in. And over the 2 weeks of paternity leave in the mornings, what would happen is after I'd bunged Caleb on the sofa at one end and sat down the other, Caleb would begin to crawl across the sofa in his big oversized sleeping bag. It was a bit laborious. And what he really wanted to do was just to recline into my lap. So Bluey's on the TV, bottles in one hand, and his other hand is just holding my face up there. It's honestly the best part of my day. Much harder to go on Twitter, but I've managed. If we want to grow in prayer, if we want to grow in our sense of friendship with God, we need to remain in his love. And I think one of the ways that we can do this is we can intentionally bring God into these things. And I know this is why the image isn't perfect, like Caleb's not bringing me in, but it's kind of like I'm seeing more of his life than I'd never seen before. It's like, let me show you this thing that I found funny. And so as we bring God into all of the areas of our life that we'd previously kept hidden and not brought him into, we find that a friendship has developed because God is in on the conversation. He's in the inner circle, and we feel like we're in his. We enjoy being in his presence. And then really what wants to happen is we want to start our day just by feeling his pleasure. I just want to feel your pleasure. I want to rest in the assurance of your love and your care as I start this day. And I had a similar experience myself at the start, start of the year. We did a 21 days of prayer and fasting, and I decided to do the Daniel fast, which I'd never done before. Unlike sort of fasting where you feel hungry and that prompts you to pray, the Daniel fast is you eat horrible food and you feel grumpy several times throughout the day and you're reminded to pray. So I did that 3 times a day plus snacks, being a little bit grumpy. But all these were opportunities to turn to God. And I found myself doing it. And I would find myself giving thanks for something that I'd seen or bringing God into the very thing that I was doing. And what I found in that experience of bringing God all the way throughout my day is that my more intentional times, which are part of the routine, those usual times were intensified. I had a deep sense of God's love, of being connected to him. No doubt in my mind or heart that this is how God felt towards me, only his love. So, Matthew, do you want to come up? I don't know if, in response to my question at the start, you thought, God loves me, but God loves me, but I think he's a little bit disappointed in me. God loves me, but I think he might be a little bit angry about this. Hours after Jesus teaches his disciples to remain in his love, he does something that ultimately proved his love for them and for all of us. And we're going to remember that now by sharing communion. And so as we share communion together, I would like to invite all of us to approach God as he truly is, full of love, full of grace, and to draw near with faith, receive his grace and his mercy in you, and to leave any false ideas about how he feels towards us at the foot of the cross. Jesus is the true vine. He has come to complete and fulfill where the original was unable. And at the cross, he demonstrated who God is and how he feels towards us. And so if you'll allow me, I'd like to remind you of who God is and what he has done for you and the great lengths he's gone to show his love. Tragically, some people have been led to believe that God is like a school teacher, or God is like Father Christmas, and he's been watching over us, he's been seeing if we're naughty or nice, and he's making a total to work out what to give us what we as we deserve. But this is not how the Bible starts. The Bible begins by revealing a God who ultimately desires to be with us. And the problem with sin, which enters the world so quickly, is not that God is displeased with us, but that God is distant. With sin, we push him further away. It causes us to lose our sense of identity, who we are, and also who we were created to be. And as the biblical story continues, with God promising Abraham and then Israel that they will be his people, he will be their God, and through them, he is going to bless the whole world, everyone in it, the whole universe. As the story goes, we know they struggle to remain faithful to this promise. And so if your image of God is in any way that he's someone who's vindictive or spiteful or angrily just pacing the room looking for someone to smite, this is not an image found in the Bible. God is always faithful to his promises that he has made. He is heartbroken. Heartbroken that humanity has lost its identity and has become separated from him. And so as the prophets foretold, God in Christ comes to earth to achieve what they could not. He comes to show that he is faithful to his covenant, not to punish us for our sin. Jesus becomes human, and he lives a perfect, righteous life. And in doing so, he merits the covenant blessings that humanity have forgotten. If Jesus did indeed look upon the vine on the temple that night that he was betrayed, he would understand that sin has not been dealt with up to this point. Even with the law, even with the atonement practice, even with the Passover sacrifices, he knew all of us were under its power. And this ultimately leads us to the cross, where God presented Jesus, the spotless Lamb of God, as the sacrifice of atonement, which means to get rid of sin, this thing that pushes us apart from God. God presented himself in Jesus, and humans killed him. Jesus' death is not a just death by the hands of God, but an unjust death at the hands of humanity. In his innocent, perfect death, he receives all human sin at the hands of sinful humanity. And as Paul says to the Corinthian church, God made him who had no sin be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Sin is condemned upon the cross, not Jesus. He has condemned sin in the flesh. In Jesus, in his death, God deals with the very root of the problem. And it's like Jesus is this lightning rod that deals with all sin, past, present, and future. All of it is consumed in his body. Sin is given what it's deserved, complete destruction. It's annihilated, it's gone forever. And what this means is that all of our brokenness, all of the promises that we've broken, all the ways we mistreat others, the unforgiveness that we hold towards others, the self-relatedness, basically anything that makes us think God loves us but is placed on Jesus, on his innocent body, and it's sentenced to death. And his final words are, "It is finished." It is finished. Jesus has experienced the death of sin, which is not his, but it's ours. And it's unfair. It's completely wrong. It's entirely unjust. It's not what Jesus deserved. It's not what we deserve. And of course, that's not the end of the story. God's justice is entirely satisfied, not at the crucifixion, but at the resurrection. The resurrection where Jesus is proven to be the innocent one. that he always was. Death cannot hold him down. His resurrection is the reversal and the reparation of all the sin that Jesus has unjustly suffered. What does this mean? Why does it matter? It means that God is not angry. John's gospel does not say God was so angry at the world that he sent his son, but he so loved the world. He's not angry, and so we never need to doubt that his love for us ever again. Not once, not ever. And the cross stands as this defining point in history that says God is for you. He loves you too much, and he doesn't want to be separated any longer, and he's proved it. He will never forget his people. He restored his covenant, and he's utterly trustworthy and righteous. He loves you because he loves you. And this means we never have to pay our way or prove ourselves to him. In the light of the cross, all of our attempts to impress God, they're absolutely nothing. We'll never be good enough, but he was and he's done it all. Such is the grace of God. He says, be free. Be free and go from all religious and legalistic and moral obligations. There's nothing you can do to make God love you more and nothing you can do to make him love you less. So what does God feel or think when he thinks about you? He thinks the world. There's no conflict of emotion, no ifs and no buts, just overwhelming and never-ending unconditional love. And so as we receive the bread and the wine, these representations of Jesus, his body and blood, the sacrifice, the length he went to show and demonstrate his love, take this grace into yourself, feed and be nourished on the true vine, and remain in his love. Amen. Let's stand.